بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه أما بعد. This is our third lesson going through تحفة الأطفال والغلمان في تجويد القرآن authored by الشيخ سليمان الجمزوري رحمه الله تعالى. We stopped at line number 6 where the author رحمه الله he said أحكام النون الساكنة والتنوين. The rules of the Nun Sakina and the Tanween. The author rahimahullah then said, لِلنُّونِ إِن تَسْكُنْ وَلِلْتَنْوِينِ أَرْبَعُ أَحْكَامٍ فَخُذْ تَبْيِينِ. So we have this letter Nun. When this Nun is found in the state of Sukun or a Tanween, it has four rules. And so take my depiction or take my clarification. So the first question that we have to answer is, what is a nun as-sakina? Every single letter in the Arabic alphabet, except for the alif, they can find themselves in one of two states, either being voweled or non-voweled. What we mean by voweled is that it will either have a fatha or a kasra or a dhamma upon it. For example, na. For example, ni. For example, nu. Right? Likewise, this same letter, for example, the noon, it can be vowelless, i.e. exist with a sukun on top of it. For example, an. You see this noon is in the state of sukun. When the noon is in the state of sukun, we can say that this is an example of a non-voweled letter. And this is what we are going to be discussing in this chapter. As for the tanween, then it is an extra type of noon sakina, which attaches onto the end of nouns during the continuation of reading. However, it is absent in the writing of the noun, and it is also absent when stopping on the word. وبالمثال يتضح المقال. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلِيمًا خَبِيرًا. As you can see here, عَلِيمًا, when I pronounced it, you heard a noon at the end, right? At the end of Aliman, you heard a noon sakin at the end. However, if you go to the Mus'haf and you pick out, let me try and write it here, inshallah, so you can see. This is how you write it. طيب, this is how you write Aliman. And so there is no noon sakina. You can't see the noon sakina written, but it's pronounced. Inna Allaha kana aliman khabira. Right? However, if I want to stop on aliman, I stop on the alif. And so I say, Inna Allaha kana alima. And as you can see, alim is a noun. So we can see the tanween, which is over here. This is the tanween. When it attaches onto the end of nouns, like alim, in the continuation of reading this word, but it's absent in the writing and also when stopping. And so in the Arabic language we say it's نون ساكنة زائدة تلحق آخر الأسماء لفظا لا خطا ووصلا لا وقفا. طيب, the next point that I want to speak about here is when the author rahimahullah says arba'u ahkamin, there are four rules. So when this noon sakina or this tanween comes before any one of the remaining letters of the Arabic alphabet, what are the rules that come out from this meeting? According to the ulama of tajweed and qira'at, they say that there are four rules that come out when we have a noon sakina followed by a letter, or a tanween followed by a letter. And of course, the tanween can only occur in the end of a word, whereas the noon sakina can occur in the middle of a word and also at the end of a word. So what are these four rules? The first rule is al-idhar, the second rule is al-idgham, the third rule is al-iqlab, the fourth rule is al-ikhfa, which we will take in detail now. The author begins with al-idhar, and he says in line 7-8, فَالْأَوَّلُ الْإِظْهَارُ قَبْلَ أَحْرُوفِ لِلْحَلْقِ سِتِّ رُتِّبَتْ فَالْتَعْرِيفِ همز فهاء ثم عين حاء مهملتان ثم غين خاء. Muhmalatani here means without dots. So you see the ayn and the ha, they don't have any dots. Whereas the ghayn and the kha, they have dots. And so the first rule here we're going to be talking about is al-idhar. What is al-idhar? Al-idhar linguistically means to make something clear or to make something apparent. And so the ruling here is that if a noon sakina or a tanween precedes any one of these six letters, which the author called huruf al-halq, the six throat letters, whether it occurs in one word or whether it occurs between two words, then the noon sakina and the tanween are to be made clear. They are to be recited or pronounced from its articulation point. The hamzah and the ha, the ayn and the ha, the ghayn and the kha, these are the letters of al-halq. These are the six throat letters. And the reason why they are called the six throat letters, or the reason why they are called throat letters, is because they all come from the throat. Their articulation point is from the throat. Whereas the articulation point of the noon, sakina, or tanween, we will take it later bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. As Ibn al-Jazari rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَالنُونُ مِنْ طَرَفِهِ تَحْتُ جَعَلُوا وَالرَّا يُدَلِيهِ لِظَهْرٍ أَدْخَلُوا. So what we're talking about here is that the noon sakina and the tanween, they are to be pronounced from their articulation point. And likewise, the hamza, the ha, or the ayn and the ha, or the ghayn and the kha, if they come after the noon sakina or the tanween, they are also to be pronounced from their articulation point. So both letters are to be pronounced from their articulation point. Okay, this is what's meant by al-idhar. Both are to be made clear, both are to be made apparent. The difference between the hamza, ha, ayn and ha, ghayn and kha, when it comes to makharij, is that the hamza and the ha come from the deepest part of the throat, i.e. the furthest part of the throat away from the fixed position being the mouth. The ayn and the ha come from the middle part of the throat, and the ghayn and the kha come from the closest part of the throat relative to the fixed position being the mouth. Here are some examples for you to read over when it comes to the letters of al-idhar. For example, the hamza, in one word, Allah said, yan'awun. As you can see here, the noon sakina is made clear. Yan'awun. Man amana. Wajannatin alfafa. You see? Yan'awun. Man hajara. Jurufin harin. An'amta. Min ilmin. Haqiqun ala. Wanhar. من حاد الله ورسوله عليما حكيما عليم حكيم فسينغضون من غل حليما غفورا والمنخنقة ولمن خاف يومئذ خاشعة.
As you can see, it is what? إظهار. The noon is made apparent, the tanween is made apparent, it is made clear. The next line that the author رحمه تعالى mentions, so he brings, he says, وَالثَّانِي دَغَامٌ بِسِتَّةٍ أَتَتْ فِيَرْمُلُونَ عِنْدَهُمْ قَدْ ثَبَتَتْ. The second rule to discuss from the four rulings is الإدغام. الإدغام linguistically means to merge. And so what's meant here is that if a noon sakina or a tanween comes before any one of the six letters that the author grouped into the word yarmulun, if they come after the noon sakina or the tanween, then some form of merging will take place between the noon sakina and tanween and those six letters. The author rahimahullah then mentions the categories of al-idgham. He says, لَكِنَّهَا قِسْمَانِ قِسْمٌ يُدْغَمَ فيه بغنة بينمو علما إلا إذا كان بكلمة فلا تدغم كدنيا ثم صنوان تلا والثاني إدغام بغير غنة في اللام والراء ثم كررن. So he mentions to us here the types or the categories of al-idgham. There are two types of idgham, an incomplete idgham and a complete idgham. We call the incomplete idgham idgham بغنة, and we call the complete idgham idgham bi ghayri ghunnah. The incomplete idgham occurs when four letters come after the noon sakina or the tanween, and they are grouped together by the author rahimahullah in the word yanmu. Yanmu. Remember, we said that the words or the letters that can come after the noon sakina or the tanween, where any or where some form of merging will take place, is gathered together in the word yarmulun. The ya, the ra, the meem, the lam, the waw, and the noon. four out of these six, when they come after the nun sakin or the tanween, what happens is an incomplete idgham, and they are gathered together in the word yanmu, meaning the ya, the nun, the mim, and the waw. As for the second type, then that is complete idgham, and this occurs when two letters come after the nun sakin or the tanween, which is the lam and the ra. So as you can see, yarmulun can be categorized into two types, yanmu and the lam and the ra. When it's yanmu, the idgham is bi gunna, it is with gunna, it is a incomplete idgham. Whereas when it comes to the lam and the ra, the idgham here will be a complete idgham, idgham bi ghayri ghunna. And so the difference between the incomplete idgham and the complete idgham is that the incomplete idgham is accompanied with this nasal sound called bi ghunna. And we'll speak about it in the next lesson bi idhnillahi ta'ala. There's a whole chapter speaking about the ghunna. Whereas the complete idgham is not accompanied by this nasal sound known as the ghunna. Below are examples, as you can see, for the idgham, the six letters yarmulun. So let's start with the ya. Qala Allahu ta'ala lan yaqdir. As you can see, there is a ghunna. If you recite this word from the nasal pharynx, you'll see this nasal sound accompanying with the merging. Lan yaqdir. As you can see, it's clearly different from man amana. The noon is crystal clear there. As for here, there's an element of merging, and this merging is an incomplete merging. Another example, wujuhun yawma'idh. Whereas the ra, it is complete idgham. So look when I say the example for the ra. Mir rabbihim, mir rabbihim. Look, the noon has been completely removed. There is no, it's been completely merged with the ra. And with the ra, the author, rahimahullah, he mentions thumma karriranah, meaning that when it comes to the ra, watch out for making too much of a takrir, a sound or a characteristic that is inherent within the ra, and we'll take this in more detail in the second text, Al-Muqaddimah Al-Juzariyah, that the ra has an intrinsic characteristic known as at-takrir. At-takrir. At-takrir means repetition. So when the ra is in the state of emphasis, which it is in this scenario, because when any merging takes place, what happens is that the letter becomes emphasized, the second letter becomes emphasized. And so when the ra is in this state of emphasis, people will try to make this sifa, this intrinsic characteristic of the ra, which is at-takrir, clear and apparent. And so they say mir rabbihim, and that's wrong, and that is incorrect. Rather, that takrir should be hidden. It shouldn't be made as clear as I made it in that pronunciation. And so you say mir rabbihim, mir rabbihim. Thamaratir rizqa, طيب. You don't make the takrir as clear. You don't say thamaratir rizqa. This takrir, which is repetition, when the tongue reverberates upon the roof of the mouth, طيب. And so you have to watch out when it comes to the ra. As Ibn al-Jazari, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَأَخْفِ تَكْرِيرًا إِذَا تُشَدَّدُ وَأَخْفِ تَكْرِيرًا إِذَا تُشَدَّدُ. As for the remaining examples, the meme, مِمَّن مَنَعْ سُرُرٌ مَرْفُوعَةٌ. As for the lam, it's like the ra, it is غَمْ بِغَيْرِ غُنَّةٌ أَلَّنْ مَا لَلُّبَدَ. There is no idgham bi ghunnah when it comes to the lam. As for the waw and noon, there is idgham. Miwa, and idgham here is of course incomplete idgham, idgham naqis. Mutahharatun wahum min noor. عاملة ناصبة. طيب. There is also a very important point to highlight when it comes to the idgham, and the author highlighted it by saying لكنها قسمان قسم يدغم فيهم بغنة بأن معلما إلا إذا كان بكلمة فلا تدغم كدنيا ثم صنوان تلا. He mentions an exception. إدغام يا أحبتي في الله can only occur between two words. It can only occur between the two words. So the noon sakina or the tamim must occur at the end of the word, and the word that comes after it must have one of the letters of yarmulun. However, if you have a noon sakin in the middle of a word and it's followed by a letter from the letters of yarmulun, and this has occurred in four words in the Quran, then the ruling here is not idgham. Rather, the ruling here is absolute idhar, which we call in the Arabic language idhar mutlaq. And these four words are dunya, qinwan, Sinwan and Bunyan. In these four words, you see the noon sakina is followed by a letter from the letters of idgham. What we should expect is idgham, but in reality, what happens here is what we call idhar mutlaq, absolute idhar. And so you have to make the noon clear and apparent, just like we made it clear and apparent for the حروف الإظهار. For the letters of الإظهار, we made the noon apparent. Likewise here, we are to make the noon apparent in these four words. So we say دنيا, قنوان, صنوان, بنيان, طيب. Then the author, رحمه الله, he said, والثالث الإقلاب عند الباء ميما بغنة مع الإخفاء. The third rule is الإقلاب. الإقلاب linguistically means to change or to flip something over. And so what's happening here is that if a noon ساكنة or a تنوين is followed by the letter باء, then the noon ساكنة or the تنوين is to be changed, is to be flipped into a hidden meme accompanied by the غنة. Into a hidden meme accompanied by the ghunnah. So what's the change here? The change here is the noon sakinah has been flipped from a noon sakinah or a tanween into a hidden meme accompanied by the ghunnah. Mimun mukhfah. And the author rahimahullah hinted at this by saying والثالث الإقلاب عند الباء ميما بغنة مع الإخفاء. ميما ميم بغنة accompanied with the ghunnah مع الإخفاء with a إخفاء. And we'll see إخفاء in the fourth ruling, and the definition of ikhfa linguistically means to hide something. And so how do we achieve this hidden meme? It is achieved by sealing the lips, whilst maintaining the sound of the meme and accompanying that sound with the ghunnah. And then after that, opening the lips again in order to recite the ba. So the hidden meme is achieved by sealing the lips whilst maintaining the meme sound, alongside accompanying that with the ghunnah, and then opening the lips again to recite the ba. And you find some people, what they do is to try to make this hukum easy. They say have a gap between the two lips when pronouncing this hidden meme, and that is incorrect. That is incorrect. What's correct is that the lips must be sealed during the pronunciation of the iqlab, of course, to get this hidden meme sound, and of course accompanying it with the ghunnah. Examples in one word and two words, and also with the tanween. So as you can see, the iqlab can occur in one word, it can also occur between two words, it can also occur with the tanween. Example, أنبئوني أنبورك ومبشرا برسول. طيب. As for the final rule, the author رحمه الله he said, والرابع الإخفاء عند الفاضل من الحروف واجب للفاضل في خمسة من بعد عشر رمزها في كلمة هذا البيت قد ضمنتها صف ذا ثنا كم جاد شخص قد سما دم طيبا زد في تقا ضع ظالما. الإخفاء linguistically means to hide something. And so what's happening here is that if the noon sakina or the tanween is followed by any one of these 15 letters that are gathered together as the first letter of each word in the final line that the author rahimahullah mentioned, صف ذا ثنا كم جاد شخص قد سما دم طيبا زد في تقا ضع ظالمة. So in any of these remaining 15 letters, if they come after a noon sakinah or a tanween, then you are to perform ikhfa, i.e. this noon sakinah or tanween is to be made hidden. How do you achieve this hiding? Is by moving your tongue near towards the articulation point of the letter that follows the noon sakinah or the tanween. Then you hold your tongue there and you accompany that with a ghunnah. And you do this as long as it takes for a person to pronounce a natural med. And a natural med, the length of a natural med is two vowel counts. Two vowel counts. مثلاً أنصدوكم. And so the first step is to take my tongue towards the makhraj of the sad. طيب. And then, of course, I don't hit directly the makhraj, but towards it, near it. طيب. And then I accompany that. I hold the tongue there and I accompany it with a ghunnah. And I hold that ghunnah for as long as it takes to pronounce a natural med. أنصدوكم أن تعتدوا. طيب. Here are some examples. I will leave them for you. I will read them out and you understand it. And see how the difference is between the إخفاء and the remaining rulings or the previous rulings that we mentioned. So let's take the صاد. ينصركم. And of course here you can see that the إخفاء can occur in one word and it can also occur in two words and it can also occur with the تنوين. ريحا صرصرا أنصدوكم منذر من ذكر سراعا ذلك منثورا من ثمرة جميعا ثم ينكثون إن كان عادا كفورا فأنجيناه أن جاءكم شيئا جنات ينشئ من شهيد عذاب شديد فيئوس قنوط من قبل منقلبون من سأته كلمة سبقت ليال سوية قوما طاغين وإن طائفتان ينطلقون and so on. طيب, so these are the examples for the 15 letters. صف ذا ثنا كم جاد شخص قد سما دم طيبا زد في تقن ضع ظالما 15 letters, the remaining 15 letters which you can memorize through that line of poetry that the author رحمه تعالى gave us. And with this we come to the end of our lesson. هذا والله أعلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.